Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome. Thank you all for coming today. We're going to get things started. Before we get today's lecture started, if everyone could please take a moment to check your cell phones, ensure they're on silent so we don't disrupt today's lecture. Thank you. I'd also like to take a moment right now to say that all of our programs here at the NHA are made possible with support from our members, and that your NHA membership helps us accomplish all that we do every single day. So if you are one of our members, we thank you. And if you have not joined yet, please do visit the friendly folks at the front desk, and we can assist you with an NHA membership. Thank you. Today's Food for Thought is brought to you by the MS Worthington Foundation, and media sponsorship is generously provided by Novation Media. Today's speaker, Mary Bergman, joins us from the Nantucket Lightship Basket Museum, where she is currently the executive director. Mary spent the last 2 years working as the museum's director and has a background in museum studies and historical interpretation. Issues of gender and women's studies unite her areas of research interest, which include maritime history, human spaceflight, and of course, Nantucket's decorative arts and craftspeople. She has held positions at the United States Capitol Visitor Center, the National Air and Space Museum, and the Nantucket Historical Association. She holds a BA in American Studies and Museum Studies from Smith College, and an MA in Public History from American University. She is active in the Nantucket community and serves on the committee of the Nantucket Book Festival and the Nantucket Cultural District Steering Committee. Please join me in giving a warm round of applause to Mary Bergman.
Boy, thanks. When I wrote that, I didn't yet have my fabulous co-pilot, Andrea Wolfliff. So I would like to introduce you to Andrea Wolfliff. Andrea joined the museum just over a month ago. She had been at the Wilton Historical Society in Wilton, Connecticut as a curator most recently. And before that, she'd worked at the Connecticut Historical Society, the National Portrait Gallery, the House of the Seven Gables, and the Fruitlands Museum. And she has a great background in New England history, decorative arts, and textile history. And she went to Smith College as well and studied at Trinity College, where she got her MA in American Studies and Museum Studies. So Andrea will be joining me in giving this presentation. And we would like to thank Bree and everyone at the NHA. I don't know if I'll thank you for putting up all those little flyers of my face, but and thank you to all of you for coming to join us today. So what's new at the Nantucket Lightship Basket Museum? Well, those are two new things right there, us, but there's more. Before we talk about a lot of the new things, I wanted to give you a little bit of a background about the museum. Has anybody been to the museum before? Oh, good. Glad to see that. Has anybody driven by the museum before? Yeah, okay. Well, the museum has been there longer than you might realize. It grew out of an exhibit that happened here at the Nantucket Historical Association in 1994. That was the NHA's centennial. It had also been 150 years of lightship baskets as we know them. Curator David Wood of the NHA had the exhibit, The Lightship Baskets of Nantucket, A Continuing Craft. And I think out of that, people really realized a desire to have a permanent space to more fully explore stories of Nantucket's craftspeople and the decorative arts with specific focus on lightship baskets. So in 1997 is when the museum was founded as an educational nonprofit. So we are in our 20th year of existence. It opened in 2000 to the public. And again, we're located on 49 Union Street, which you are supposed to come to a complete stop before you take that hard left. Some of you don't. We see you. next time you drive by, come and visit us. We're open. If you'd like to know how to get into that parking lot, I'd be happy to tell you how that works, too. But so the museum's been there about 17 years. Hi, Beverly. Who are we? Well, you've learned a little bit about Andrea and myself. There is a very active board. Some of you are here. Thank you. We have very wonderful volunteers. That's really one of the things that made me want to work at the museum, is that there are 30 volunteer docents and weavers who help staff our summer. When we're open in the summer, they give tours, they do weaving demonstrations, they're fantastic. We have more than 100 yard sale volunteers. Some of them I see here, so I thank you for coming as well. We have a youth weaving program where we have 6 youth weaving teachers that teach over 50 students a year. We have 2 students right now who are working as teachers, and we have 1 staff assistant in the summertime as well. So there are a lot of people that make up this little museum. And why do we have a museum about lightship baskets? Have you ever asked yourself that question? Maybe. Well, Nantucket's basketry and folk art history really enables people to explore Nantucket's path through the lens of its craftspeople. And what I like about that is so many of these people were everyday people. They were like you and I. They were engaging with something that they didn't know was going to be a museum about them one day. They were just making baskets in their spare time, or maybe as a retirement career later on. We also get to learn a lot about the people who owned the baskets, and that gives us another interesting glimpse into Nantucket's history. So I really like that. And
lightship baskets, as someone from off the island too, they've really become the icon of the island. When people are away from here and they think of Nantucket, the basket is one of the first things that they think about.
Yeah, absolutely. But we are more than the yard sale, too. Has anybody been to the yard sale before? That's what I was thinking, yes. I touched on a couple of our programs, our youth weaving classes that we have year-round. And if you do have children or grandchildren aged 9 to 13 who you think might be interested in these classes, they are offered at a low or no cost for the first class, and that's due to a generous grant from the Nantucket Golf Club and the support of a lot of donors. So I'd be happy to give you more information about that afterwards. That does happen year-round. We have a class that they just put the rims on their baskets yesterday, so they are almost done. We are open April through October, so we'll be opening very soon, sooner than you would think. We have a seasonally changing exhibit, so that's really exciting. Every year there's something new, something different to see. We take everything out at the end of the year. We put new things in the beginning of the year. We have weaving demonstrations, as I mentioned. And then around Stroll, we're open for what we call the Basket Festival and Sale. So that's where local artists get to show off some of their work, and you can come and support the museum and support them. We are a small museum. We have a small collection. It's all stored off-site at a secret space, but because of the NHA, other institutions, and a lot of our collectors and our volunteers, people who are members of the museum, we are able to have a completely different exhibit every year. And that's really fantastic that we have such a community behind the museum, and that the NHA and Tony, such a help. We'll be writing you soon with our list for this year. It is really incredible, the support from the community that's behind the museum to be able to create these exciting narratives. So, and I'm happy that you're all here today. I did just want to mention briefly the idea of lightships and lightship baskets, because I think sometimes this comes up and we can get stuck on what is a lightship basket, and if it wasn't made on a lightship, was it really a lightship basket? Were these baskets only made on lightships? Were they first made on the lightships? We weren't there, but we don't think that they were. And we know that by the time that this ship here, the New South Shoal, this was the second ship to be anchored on the South Shoals, was placed into service in 1856, people were bringing on board the component parts to make lightships. They weren't milling down the trees to make the molds or to make the handles and things like that on board the ship. They were coming on with the component parts. So it existed as an art form prior to the lightships, but it's really the lightship, the image of the lightship and all that that represents, that has come to make these baskets so iconic. It's really all about branding. People talk about branding a lot now, but lightship baskets are, I think, really intrinsically linked to this idea of a romantic past that we'll touch on in a little bit. But this year's exhibit, I'm testing this image so you can let me know what you think. This year's exhibit is called Breaking the Mold. This is a mold. Women in Nantucket Folk Arts. And it will celebrate the contributions of women like ivory carver and woodworker Aletha Macy, who you see in the picture up behind me. Throughout Nantucket's history, there have been many women who have left their mark on the world of traditional maritime crafts. And we are going to explore that and share that with you. This is going to be a little bit of a trailer. We're kind of sharing some of the research that we have found about the earliest years of lightship baskets and women's involvement, in the hopes that you will say, boy, that sounds interesting and I'd like to learn more. So throughout, every culture has its own basket making tradition. And that's one of the other great things about this museum, is getting to learn and think about other places than Nantucket and how do we fit into that larger picture. Excuse me. And some of the basket making traditions are matrilineal, and they're passed down from mother to daughter, grandmother to granddaughter, and some father to son, or male friends or male relatives. I think that basketry is really interesting because you're making a connection, you're weaving yourself. It encourages a connection to homeland, to ancestors, whether it's the material you're using or the style, the technique that you're using, or to a moment in time. In Nantucket basketry in particular, you're really connecting yourself to this maritime past, what I'm calling this romantic maritime past. If you see the quote up on the left-hand side, that's from Gustav Kobe's piece, Life on the South Shoal Lightship, which was published in 1891 in Century Magazine. The important thing to pick out from that is that a sailor is describing the loneliest thing he'd ever seen at sea, and the loneliest thing he'd seen at sea was a polar bear drifting on a piece of ice in the Arctic Ocean. And the second loneliest thing was the Nantucket Lightship, because it was anchored 30 to 50 miles off the coast of Nantucket. So when people are walking on the Sconset Bluff and they say, oh, there's nothing between us and Portugal except for water, that wasn't true until 1986. The lightship was there. And it was not serviced between November and May because of the weather by a relief ship. So these men were out there, and from 1854 to 1905, it was Nantucketers who were there. Most of them were retired whaling captains. So 4 months or 5 months away from home, that was nothing to these guys who'd been sailing around the world for 4 or 5 years at a time. I wouldn't want to do it, but they were hardier stock. And the man that you see there is Captain Andrew Jackson Sansbury. He's an interesting fellow. He had served on a whaler, then on the lightship, then on a whale ship, and then he was the lighthouse keeper at Brant Point Station. And that's what he's wearing in that outfit, is a lighthouse keeper uniform. So he was also making baskets. He's just a great example of one of the men who would have been making baskets at the time. By the turn of the century, after the whaling industry, 1870s to 1900, Nantucket is no longer the island that lights the world. The whaling industry's died out, and if you've been through the Whaling Museum, you know those reasons why. New Bedford had a deeper harbor, they discovered oil in Titusville, Pennsylvania, there's the gold rush and the Civil War, there's a lot of reasons why people are leaving the island. But in the 1870s, people are rediscovering Nantucket as a tourist destination, as a place with healing waters and a place to take in the air. On a day like today, it's easy to believe why. So tourists are coming, and when tourists come, they need souvenirs. And lightship baskets very quickly became part of the tourist trade. It was a way for tourists to connect with Nantucket. It was a way for them to have this genuine reminder of their stay.
Well, in order to understand why studying women's role in basket making is worthwhile, first we need to look at the unique role that men played in making Nantucket lightship baskets. And prior to the early 1900s, this really was the domain of men. And there are other basket making traditions, as Mary mentioned, that were predominantly men. The construction of the Nantucket basket and the era in which they were made really played a large role in why that was the case here. The earliest written record we have for the presence of a rattan, they were called rattan baskets before they were called lightship baskets, rattan baskets on the island was from a newspaper article, the Nantucket Weekly Mirror, in 1861. A 12-year-old boy named Joseph Farnham had entered his made-by-himself rattan basket in the 6th Agricultural Exhibition. And Farnham later went on to write a memoir of his childhood called, it's a long title here, Brief Data and Memories of My Boyhood Days in Nantucket. They actually have this book at the Athenaeum, and It's a really fascinating read if you want to know what it was like to live in the mid-19th century on Nantucket through the eyes of a 12-year-old boy. It's fascinating. But in this book, he describes sitting in his father's workshop with other men learning how to make these baskets. His father had been a pump maker and a block maker for the whaling ships. And as the whaling industry declined, he had an empty workshop and a lot of time on his hands, and he turned to basket making. And this was a social activity. It was clearly a hobby, not something he was doing as an occupation, but something that he was doing with the materials he had on hand to fill up his spare time. And that's possibly one reason that women were not involved in this. They were not in the workshops. They didn't have the same downtime that the men had at this point either. So it was definitely a social atmosphere. Oh, actually, I should have shown the picture of the... Sorry, Mary. Did it go back?
Sorry.
This is a picture of the Pacific Club. And men were used to being with other men. They spent years on whaling ships with other men. So when they came back on land, the captains created a space for them to continue that camaraderie.
Which you also described as in the wood shop as well.
In the wood shop as well.
To other, mm-hmm. Yeah,
and just kind of probably stay out of their wives' hair a little bit as well, I imagine. So another reason that women were not involved in this, really, I think, is the more important reason, is that the tools, the woodworking tools and the materials were something that were so familiar to the men working on the ships or having wood shops, but they really weren't familiar to women. Let's look at a basket. So first you need the mold, which was... Sorry.
Just the baleen. It's okay.
The molds, which are handcrafted using woodworking tools and lathes. We have this is a base, this has a wooden base that needs to be shaped and carved.
On a lathe.
Yeah, all of these require woodworking tools. So you have the staves that form the rims of the basket, ridges, the actual form of the basket.
Yeah.
And they were carved and molded by hand. The actual handles of the baskets need to be bent and carved over a wooden mold as well. So all of these things were things that women didn't have just laying around their homes. And the rattan itself that it's used to weave the basket was a packing material on whaling and merchant ships. So this was something that men working around the docks had access to. It had been used for caning of chair seats for a long time before the baskets even were being made. So they were used to working with this material. And let's see.
But that's not to say that there were no women who were making baskets at all during that time, or even making lightship baskets. This was one of the most, I think, exciting things that we discovered when we were doing some research, is that a woman named Lydia Peace Carr Hammond, right there, Mrs. L.C. Hammond, came in third place for a rattan basket. She won a prize of 25 cents in 1866 at the Agricultural Fair. So the Agricultural Society was established in 1856 as a way to encourage Nantucketers to try out other pursuits, now that whaling was clearly not going to be the way that they made their money. And by 1864, there was a category for rattan baskets, or what we'd come to know as lightship baskets. Andrea mentioned that earlier, with that young boy, Joseph Farnham, entering and winning a prize. Did he win a prize, or just enter?
He just entered.
Oh, he just entered. Well, anyway, Lydia came in third place. So we know she made this basket. We don't really know a whole lot about her, though, unfortunately. If you do, I'd love to know. She was born in 1821, and she died in 1887 in Brockton. She was part of that exodus. She and about 100 other Nantucketers were in Brockton at the time. And she had a husband who was a carpenter. So that gives me enough information to know that she was around somebody who knew their way around woodworking tools, who would have had access to some of these materials. It's possible that he helped her put together this basket, or it's possible that she learned how to make baskets like many people did, which is they took one apart to try to figure out how it was made. So this was very interesting to me to find some written record of a woman making baskets prior to 1900. So we'll hope to learn more about her once we can get in touch with the folks up in Brockton.
Well, one way that women really were involved in spreading the popularity of the baskets and making them into a Nantucket icon was as retailers and sort of the middleman between the men who were making the baskets and the visitors to the island who were buying them. This on the left there, you see an ad from the paper in 1878.
Do you want the device?
Oh, sure.
That one, the red one.
The red button? Okay, here we go. So Mrs. George R. Folger, who was actually Catherine Macy, is the only agent for the sale of our baskets in this town. Those wishing a superior article in this line will do well to call and examine them at the store of C.E. Allen, corner of Main and Federal Streets. And it's signed Thomas S. James and Andrew Sansbury. Andrew Sansbury was the gentleman with the beard that you saw a few slides ago. Thomas James made this lovely basket right here. They were both stationed on the South Shoal Lightship. So they were legitimate lightship basket makers. And they wanted to protect their identity as the only real lightship basket makers. And C.E. Allen was Charles Allen. He owned a pharmacy on the corner of Main and Federal Streets. And Mrs. Folger had a shell shop within the pharmacy where she sold all kinds of trinkets and things that were indicative of Nantucket life. And among them were the baskets. 2 years later, in 1880, she has her own store. Mr. Allen had passed away and closed his shop had closed. And here she is offering, this was two doors above the post office. She has a splendid assortment of curiosities, moss and shellwork, seashells, homemade fancy articles, old crockery, and a large variety of rattan baskets, again, made on board of the South Shoal Lightship. This seemed to be an important characteristic for the baskets that they were selling. And I love the old crockery. She's really evoking that idea of this old seafaring community. It's right. Kind of funny to us that it was in...
Even in 1880, people are already starting to look back.
Another way that Mrs. Folger may have been the first to have her store selling these baskets, but you can see they expanded. Petticoat Row is what they called Center Street, as many of you already know. So many women owned shops on that street that it was called Petticoat Row, and those are some of the women there who ran the shops. Phoebe Clisby is one of those women, but we're not sure exactly which one she is. But you can see Phoebe Clisby was a school teacher, and she also taught sewing on Orange Street. She inherited this shop from her mother's first cousin, and she ended up selling lightship baskets and artist materials. This seems to be for people who are maybe here for a longer stay than just on and off the boat. Phoebe Clisby, incidentally, was a broker for the baskets as well, maybe possibly not formally a broker, but informally. When Henry Cabot Lodge wanted to purchase a set of nesting baskets for the First Lady, Edith Roosevelt, he wrote to Phoebe Clisby, and she arranged for William Appleton to make those baskets for her. And they went off, and it was all in the newspaper, because everything that happened on the island was in the newspaper. So,
thank God.
Thank goodness, I know, it's a great resource for us.
If you haven't looked through the digital archives of the INM and the other papers on Nantucket at the Times, it's accessible through the library. It's a fantastic resource, and we really are so lucky as a community to have that. So, I wanted to share with you a couple other things that we found. I think that and women have really been involved in Nantucket basket making. I hope that this shows you that they were there, whether we saw them or not. They were behind the scenes. But they started to come to the forefront in the 1900s. We'll talk, when you come to the museum in April, you'll learn about the Coffin School and the Coffin School baskets and what was happening there. Here are two pieces that I really love, two newspaper clippings that or magazine clippings. By 1949, the image on the left is of Women's Day magazine. Women's Day had traveled to Nantucket. They met with Mitchie Ray, who, if you know anything about baskets, will be a name that's familiar to you. He was really the last of the old-time basket makers, and he was in our fifth slide, I believe. She met with Mitchie Ray and learned how to make a basket. And I love these pictures because they show a woman, using those tools, and we talk about that being a barrier to entry. And even today, there are many women who are involved with basket making, but maybe not to the extent that they would like to be because they did not take shop class in school and they did not, learn how to use a lathe or anyway. But here in 1949, in Mitchie Ray's shop, a woman is making a basket. I don't know if anybody read this and then made a basket of their own If they did, I would love to see it. The apple basket that's up in the top left there, that was really the basket that would have been associated with Nantucket up until the 1950s, when you have the introduction of the friendship basket, that covered purse that you see people carrying around now or taking to church on Sundays. And by the 1950s and 60s, women are involved in the basket world as consumers, and they are driving this new industry of the basket as a fashion accessory and icon. And this ad on the right is from Saks Fifth Avenue in 1967, ran in the New York Times as a two-page ad advertising a knockoff basket that sold at Saks in the 60s. And they're also really selling Nantucket through those pictures and a lifestyle. And it's just fascinating to me how quickly this changed, you know, and it went from being a utilitarian object to something that was very, very coveted. You had a lot of men who were helping to open the world to women. There were those out there who were willing to share those secrets. It's a picture of Jose Reyes teaching basket making to Nantucket Girl Scouts. The girl pictured is not here. I was not going to call her out even if she was here, but oh, anyway, fantastic. And then the other image is of Lincoln Seeley, who's standing in the doorway, and Aletha Macy, who's in the white. Aletha Macy, again, an ivory carver, woodworker, who Lincoln Seeley really took under his wing and taught her a lot of different crafts. And in some instances, women had to learn these things on their own. Today, there are a lot of women who are making their living selling their work, and even more who enjoy it as a pastime. And these women have gone on to teach others, and they have allowed the craft to really continue. One last piece that I just want to mention, and you would have learned about if you came to the museum last year, is that the women in Japan are really fascinated with Nantucket baskets. There are about 2,000 women in Japan who are making Nantucket Lightship baskets, and not only are they making them, they love them, and they carry them around. So if you have your basket on a shelf and you think, boy, this is kind of old-fashioned, it can look cool, as these young ladies look pretty hip. But it is incredible that through women's involvement in the last, you know, 20 or 30 years, the craft in Nantucket Lightship Baskets has really taken off and is not going away. So we certainly hope that you will come and see our exhibit, Breaking the Mold, Women in Nantucket Folk Arts. I have to thank Brittany Thurman for letting us use the letterpress to create this. We were sitting around looking at the old ads, which are just so fantastic, and I said, boy, I wish we could find a font that looks like that. And then I remembered we could use the actual machine to make these, to make our own image. So that is a little bit about what's going on at the Lightship Basket Museum, what's keeping us up at night these days. And if you have any questions or anything at all you'd like to talk about, just let us know. Thank you.
If anyone has a question, please raise your hand and we'll open up the floor for an audience Q&A. If there are any questions in the audience.
There are also brochures up here.
And you're also welcome to come up and talk to Mary and Andrea afterwards as well.
Yeah.
Oh, we've got one from Peggy. Here you go.
Well, I really appreciated hearing about your programs, and I know most of the community knows about the very successful community sale that's held every November, and what you might not know is that the Lightship Basket Museum also will coordinate private sales. And as you know, they're very experienced at this from the community sale. And when we're getting ready to move, they're going to have a sale for us. And they'll come in and price things. And then we can disappear so we don't have the pain of being there when we see the things disappear. So if any of you are thinking of spring cleaning or something, just call and line up your own sale.
That's right. We'll be in Peggy's house May 13th. Pardon? Well, I say we'll be in your house soon.
Well, I actually have a question for the two of you. What was your inspiration for this? Like, why now? What was, you know, the timing? Was it just kind of something that you had on your list, a dream list?
Yes. I think this is something that I'd wanted to do. I think, well, I can tell you what the impetus is when a husband and wife come to the museum and a man sits on the bench outside and says that he doesn't want to come in. So I've really decided that it's fascinating to me because there are so many men involved in basketry, and it really, in Nantucket basketry in particular, that a lot of people don't think that women had any involvement in the early years, not until, Susan Chase Otison in the 60s starts making baskets. But there are really were people there behind the scenes, and I think, you know, when Andrea joined the staff, and obviously we both have an interest in women's history, we both went to a women's college, we talk about the reasons as to why you don't see women in history is just as important as to why you might see them. So it's been an interesting challenge to sort of do a lot of this like back-end research to find people throughout. And I think last year with the passing of Nancy Chase, who's a great scrimshander and a great artist, I didn't want to miss the opportunity to honor her work. And that brought us to Aletha Macy and a lot of other people who were involved in different aspects of folk arts.
A question back here.
Hi.
Hi.
Well, not necessarily a question, just a few comments related to the first slide and the last line of the presentation. So the first slide with the beautiful image of the exhibit catalog in that David Wood curated.
Yeah.
I remember it was the summer of 2001 when somebody knocked at the storage facility door at 89 Bartlett. Back then, I was an intern with the NAJ.
Yeah.
And when that door is locked all the time. So when I unlocked the door, the gentleman looked at me and said, "Who are you?" Those who remember David Wood probably remember his voice and, you know, look. So, well, good afternoon, sir. My name is Tony, and I'm the new NAJ intern. Interestingly enough, I was looking and reading through this catalog, and he looks at me and said, "Do you know anything about Nantucket baskets?" And I said, "No, I'm about to learn. I'm interested more in scrimshaw because that was my my big thing." And he looked at me and said, "Well, if you're interested in scrimshaw, then you should also get interested in baskets because there is a very close connection between scrimshaw and basket making. We all know that scrimshaw is basically the artwork of the Whalers, scrimshaw, or the scrimshawed medallions on top of the friendship baskets actually is a continuation of the scrimshaw artwork. And since then, I also love baskets. And I'm the lucky one to walk through the shelves at the Gosnell Center and see Nancy Chase's spirit and see David Wood's spirit and Fernand Silvero's spirit because we have all these baskets. Now to the last slide. It's very interesting to see the Japanese ladies. Unfortunately, I missed the exhibit, but interestingly, when Mary said that Japanese ladies like to carry these baskets, well, there is a nice anecdote, and I think most of you know it, but it's probably part of the Nantucket folklore that two women wearing a friendship basket met either in Paris or in Athens. That's a rumor. They were both English-speaking, and one woman asked the other, "Are you from Nantucket?" by looking at her basket, at the friendship purse. And the other woman answers, "No, I'm from Sconset." Well, that's congratulations, Mary and Andrea. Welcome. And
thank you.
You
thank
know you, where John. You can find us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Do we have any other questions before we wrap things up? Okay. Well, let's give one another big warm round of applause. A huge thank you for joining us today. Next week, we'll be back for Food for Thought. Michael Harrison, our chief curator, will be talking about a Arctic whaling voyage, a lesser known whaling voyage about whaling in the Arctic. So we hope to see you back next week. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thanks so much.